The study of chemistry helps us to explain our world, and chemistry has started long ago. And in the textbook, you will find this picture of an alchemist's lab from circa 1580, where these workers are mixing things together and heating things and stuff like this. Starting with even the invention of fire and burning something was causing a chemical reaction. Chemists could then use these, alchemists really, could use the heat to smelt metals, create new alloys that were useful. Chemists also worked on plants to try to isolate drug molecules, for example, opioids, which would help with pain, or aloe, or other things like this. Even alcohol was produced by fermentation reactions. So alchemy really started as the practical as a very practical thing, where people were trying to make things that they actually needed. And they may not have understood very well exactly why these things were made. Maybe someone got lucky and figured out that if you did a certain process, you would get something useful. And then other people just followed that process. But over time, we've made this as a more systematic approach. And we've tried to isolate the variables and have a more detailed understanding of what is going on. It's very important to also be aware that chemistry is the central science. And if we go back over to the textbook for a second, you can see this nice slide. In a previous video, I already mentioned this. So even if you're not particularly interested in chemistry, but maybe you're interested in medicine or biology or food or agriculture or geology or environmental science or any of these types of things, you're going to have to know a little bit of chemistry. And this course is a great opportunity for you to get a little exposure to chemistry, and hopefully you can use this information as you move on in your interest in other things. And if you are a chemistry major, that's great, and we're happy to have you. Next, the next thing I want to talk about is a little bit about the scientific method. And in my opinion, the scientific method is kind of overblown and sound more important than it actually is. This is how human beings think. You could actually make an argument that this is how any living thing thinks. So scientists gather and categorize information. They continually question the world and what we think we know, and they follow this scientific process. So what I want to do is give you an example of how one could follow the scientific process if, for example, their car doesn't start. So let's say, for example, one wakes up in the morning and their car doesn't start. So the car doesn't start. In the scientific method, we would call this an observation. So this is the beginning of the scientific method. Our observation is the car doesn't start. Then we ask why. Why doesn't that car start? This is a question. So we ask a question based on our observation. Then we make an educated guess. Maybe battery is dead. We don't know that, but the battery is dead. This is called a hypothesis. A hypothesis is a logical guess for why our observation is the case. So why the car doesn't start. Well, what would one do if the battery is dead? I guess you kind of have two choices. You could replace the battery, or in this case, I'm going to say jumpstart the car. And what you're doing is you're seeing, does the car start? In the scientific world, this is called an experiment. So we have an observation, the car doesn't start, a question, why is that the case? A hypothesis, the battery is dead, and an experiment, jumpstart the car. This is, of course, followed by the car starts or it doesn't, which is another observation. And if, unfortunately, the car doesn't start, you have to go back to this question. Why? and then pick another explanation. Maybe it's out of gas. Maybe something else is wrong with the car. That's not the important point here. But the important thing to remember here is we're all scientists. This is how we all critically think about problems that we face every day. This is just one example. Hopefully you don't face the problem of your car doesn't start every day. But we face issues every day, and this is how we logic our way through them or critically think about these types of things. However, in the scientific method, it can to some extent go a little bit further, because if we get to the point where we do enough experiments, so here we make an observation, ask a question, form a hypothesis that answers that question, make a prediction based on the hypothesis, do an experiment, and analyze the results. Sometimes we do lots and lots and lots of experiments, and we could come up with something called a theory. And a theory is something, is a hypothesis that holds up to many experimental trials. So one example of a theory is Dalton's atomic theory. And Dalton's atomic theory is essentially saying that the atom, or that the world, is made up of these tiny particles that he calls atoms. So this is Dalton's atomic theory. Today, this is pretty much considered common knowledge, that the world is made up of atoms. But back in his day, this was a more prominent theory. But we continue to do experiments. We've done experiments for, you know, almost 700 years now, and they've all seemed to support the idea that there is these things called atoms. So, therefore, this theory still holds up. Maybe tomorrow, probably unlikely, that someone will discover something else and this theory will no longer hold up and we'll have to change the theory. Theories in science differ from scientific laws. Laws, such as the law of gravity, tells us that this ball will fall to the ground. So this is the law of gravity. We're all familiar with the law of gravity, right? Everything's attracted to the earth. If you jump, you come back down. If you throw a ball up in the air, it falls back to the earth. So we're all familiar with this law. Notice there's no explanation for why this is the case, right? There's no reason why this ball falls to the earth. It's just a reproducible result. No matter how many times we drop the ball, it will fall down. That's a law. Energy cannot be created nor destroyed. That's a scientific law. It just can't happen. This differs from a theory in that it's just a reproducible observation, but it doesn't have any details with it, right? There's no explanation. Dalton's atomic theory has a lot of explanatory power that explains how chemical reactions occur and why nature behaves the way that it does. The law of gravity just tells us that things will fall over and over again. That's not to say it's not important. Of course, this is extremely important, right? We need to be aware of this law. However, it does differ from a scientific theory.